How's everyone doing? Any questions from this morning? Let's practice. Yeah, friend. Microphone. Mic. The first thing we do is get the mic ready. Yeah.
I have a question that's been sort of eating at me, not from this morning, but from last Thursday's Nikaya's talk. We were talking about fuels and nutrients, and the Buddhist teachings are basically that food precedes craving and clinging, and discussion of that. And what has been eating at me, because he also talks about wholesome and unwholesome, what has been eating at me is if one is committed or attached to eating well, you know, like vegetables, organic, etc. Is that an attachment? Is that right view? How do we balance sort of a rigidity for something that's good with not attaching?
Okay. Depends on what you mean by good. If you're eating what you perceive to be healthy, nutrient, and you're not overeating, you're just taking care of the body. Right? So, in times when you are unable to have that, if you're not making a thing out of it, meaning you may be eating out, or someone else may be preparing food, or this month you're not able to have this and that particular things, right? Whatever circumstance, and you're becoming vexed, that means you're addicted. That means it's an attachment. Attachment is reifying some view, understanding, perception into a thing. Yeah.
Yes, that's very clear. Thank you.
So this goes with everything.
Yeah.
This goes with everything. Like, for example, my teacher, when we were about to get a vehicle, a car, for the monastery, my teacher was like presidents. He saw through three presidents go to him for meditation. So he's invited to different things. And it's time for us to purchase a car. So some of the monastics said, we just get whatever cheap car there is. There's no attachment, right? And some other people, no, we have to. We have to play the part. If you go to a certain circumstances, you go to a public space, you gotta have a decent car. So we ended up getting a new Volvo. Now some people saw that as attachment. My teacher says, no. If a Volvo were to blow up, no problem. But to this circumstance, we need to have a car. You have to look a certain way. You know? for them. Right? So the stuff that we have for ourselves, we have underwear for like 30 years. The elasticity is already gone. Clip it and wear it. You know, when you go to a certain place, you have to dress a certain way for them. Right? That was my teacher's view. Right? Same thing with the car that I have. It's rebuilt. I fix it myself, but the engine is good. The transmission is good. So it'll last me a long time. Right? So it's not rocket science, the cars. Changing caliber, changing brakes, you just have to learn it. You know? I've even done body work. I used to be an artist. I do sculpture. Not rocket science. You know? Shape the, you know, the things. Something that's useful. So useful for the body, useful for circumstances. What needs to be done, what can be done. You know? For ourselves, don't make anything into a thing. If it's useful, use it. If when you don't have it, that's fine. Use something else. Like if you work, you have the means, you get organic vegetable because of your perception you think is good for you. Nutrient. So you eat it. When you don't have the means, you don't become vexed by it. The sutra, Vimalakirti Sutra. Vimalakirti. You read that sutra, right? Wealthy, prosperous merchant. Vimalakirti. He behaved like a wealthy, prosperous merchant. Inside, no attachment. It's just playing the part. In the world, not really attached to the world. Okay? Yeah. Any other question? Yeah, please.
I have a question about practice. And, even like through sitting through meditation or just like through like daily life, like I experience like some like discomfort and pain normally, and also for like while you're sitting, you know, your legs can fall asleep. How exactly do you maybe not reconcile with that, but just like focus? Like I've noticed sometimes if I'm meditating, like pain or like discomfort will be something that I can like focus on, but sometimes I also just kind of put treat as a backdrop. I was wondering if you have any
things okay. to say about that. Where is the pain?
Stomach. I've been going to try to figure out like with doctors like what's going on, but I'm not sure yet. So
yeah. Is it the stomach or the intestines? Like where is the actual location?
More intestines, I think.
Okay. And what kind of food do you eat? Do you eat meat? Do you eat vegetables or what?
Yeah, I cook all my food myself, meat, vegetables, fruits. I try to keep a balanced diet. I don't do gluten or like lactose anymore.
Mm. How long has been the pain? This is while you sit, right?
It's more constant, but also while I sit. Mm. And for like practice in daily life, it's something that like I have to like deal with. And while I sit, it's another thing that I have to consider, I guess.
Yeah. How long has it been like this?
Years. I only became aware of it. It was something that was normal to me, but I'm realizing that like there is something that's going on there that I'm trying to figure out. So
it's been years. You only recently become aware that not everyone have stomach ache all the time.
Yeah.
What? Okay, on a level, I'm trying to assess the situation. On level 1 to 10, 10 is excruciating. What are we talking about in daily life? Constant, basically.
It ranges from, I'd say, 3 to 6. It's not excruciating. It never mm-hmm. really has been, but it's definitely like noticeable and like okay. prevalent.
And have you discovered some pattern into this?
Not
like perfect. Stress versus the period when you are experiencing stress, it goes up, or a certain type of food, or you don't eat food, it goes up and down, any kind of pattern like that?
Yeah, so there's some connection with food and some connection with stress. I think when I'm in like more stressful situations, it gets a little bit worse. And some foods, like I've noticed with like a lot of dairy products and things that are high in lactose, they bother me. And sometimes I just eat something and I don't know what's different, but it also bothers me. So I like eating new things. So it's sometimes I'll have something new and I won't feel good, but
yeah,
I'll try to stick. Like there's some foods that work for me and I try to eat those as much as I can. But
yeah.
If I'm going to the store and something else is on sale or doesn't seem like it'll aggravate me, it does, then I don't get it again.
But. Yeah. If when you eat a food that agrees with your stomach, what kind of food are they?
Very like simple foods. Like every morning, basically, I have oatmeal with some blueberries, some sugar, some spices, and that has never caused me problems.
Mm.
So.
And when you eat that, you don't have stomach ache?
I wouldn't say it causes a stomach ache. Like I feel like
It causes stomach?
It does not.
It doesn't cause stomach ache.
But if I'm already not feeling well, it won't do much more to make me feel better.
I see.
A lot of the time I don't feel well.
All right, so this is a situation that's not connected to sitting per se. It's about your body chemistry.
Mm-hmm.
And your microbiome. So my suggestion is you go to an acupuncturist and I'll give you a name. So what you have to do is figure out your, lack of better term, body chemistry. There's certain food that agrees with you, certain food that doesn't. And that has to do with your microbiome. We as human beings have no capacity of digesting food. What digests food are the bacteria in the intestines. Right? So your pain is located in the intestines. That means, were you like this when you were a little boy, or not really?
I don't really know when it started. It's been going on for a while.
Yeah.
My mom, I don't know, like, I've always, like, never liked eating much because I think a lot of the discomfort that was associated with it, and I just never put two and two together until, like, recently, but
yeah.
My mom has always noticed that something was off. She tried to go to some places, but eventually I just started ignoring it, and now I'm realizing that I should not have been ignoring it.
So, yeah. The reason why certain food don't agree with us is either, I'm not an expert, but it's either you lack the particular bacteria that actually can take certain food, or meaning like you lack the bacteria, so the bacteria doesn't know what to do with it. You know? And it creates some problems there. Or the bacteria in your intestine, they're not getting what they need to get. So they're, I wouldn't say malnourished, you're feeding the wrong things to them. So they create gas, acid, pain, and all kinds of stuff. And one can tell that by the fecal matter, but I'm not going to embarrass you by asking you that question publicly with Zoom. But you should see this acupuncturist, so we have to identify, you know, what is going on. Yeah.
Yeah. And so for, I am working to do that. I'm working to solve the issue. But in the meantime, as I just have to live with this, is there, like, should I still be putting it aside, or should I be, like, aware of it and just have it exist alongside everything else?
You should definitely be aware of it and be conscious of recognizing patterns and jot them down. Don't try to keep it all here in your memory. That's not reliable. So experiment and observe and keep track of that. And the more you understand the pattern, the better it is. And try to bring your body back to health. You know? Anyone else in your family experiencing this? I'm trying to identify this hereditary, because when you're born with a certain bacteria stomach, it comes from somewhere.
Yeah. I think, I don't know if anyone has as severe problems in my family, but I think my mom has mentioned that like grandma has had some stomach issues, but I don't think they ever really looked into them too much.
Right.
My dad has had some things, but also I don't think it's as severe.
Who is your mom very healthy?
Yes.
Mm.
She has
migraines.
Do you
have siblings?
But other than that, what?
Do you have siblings?
Yes. I have one sibling.
One sibling. And how is this person's health?
Their health. I think it's...
Do they have stomach issues?
No.
No. Okay. See, the microbiomes that we're born with, that we can possibly cultivate, like the Buddha says, you know, have said, that there are innumerable sentient beings inside us. This is like 2,500 years ago. They don't have the science, the equipment, but this whole body is made up of bacteria, sentient being. And we have a skewed understanding of bacteria, like a bias, like it's not good. But that's wrong. Most of the bacteria don't do damage to us. In fact, we need it to survive. So they help us do a lot of things, including our psychological welfare. And they produce, they're in charge of producing positive chemicals in the body. like 90% of our serotonin is produced in the gut. That's the feel good. So that means when they are fed properly and your livelihood is stable, we feel good about ourselves. But some of these bacteria, when they go awry, they produce negative feelings in ourselves. That means some of your stress, if you're prone to stress, it means your bacteria is a certain way. And they know this because there's a practice called, I can't remember the exact term, but something like fecal transplant. And people have done this. When they are very sick, they can't eat certain food, they're constantly having stomach issues. So they go through the doctors to do this. They don't just take fecal matter, okay? So they take samples and they make it into kind of pills and so on from different people in their family. Like this one case in which this person took it from the brother. This woman took it from the brother, their siblings. And the brother's gut is very healthy, but that brother has depression, symptoms of depression for much of his life. And when she took it, her gut became better, but she started to have depression. That means, and then when she stopped taking it, she stopped having that. That means it's the microbiome. And then the doctors working with her are experimenting. So they took it from the mother, the father, and her boyfriend, you know, different stuff, until they got like the right mix, you know. So some of you who feel like depressed or anxious, you think it's part of your personality, you think it's you. Like the Buddha says, no self, nothing to do with you. It's the microbiomes, you know. So even feelings that we have that makes us feel like it's just me, because it's been part of me, may not actually be you. It's just the things that's inside your body. And it's changeable. Fecal transplant is a very radical kind of treatment. The people don't usually do that. A more gentle approach is through acupuncture and Chinese medicine, to slowly, because you can't really introduce something radical. The body needs time to adapt. Otherwise, the symptoms are very prominent. Like if you introduce new thing, it becomes very prominent, right? So you want to gradually grow and cultivate positive bacteria. Yeah. That can lead to kind of psychological well-being, physical health, right? But first, you need to identify. Yeah. In the meantime, we keep track, very clear what's happening, what patterns, and we make sure we don't add to our symptoms with stress. So it's like a scientist doing experimentation on your body. And part of the practice of not to make it stressful is your perception. So you have to perceive not being threatened by it. Your perception cannot feel threatened or bad or worrisome. So you have to look into yourself whether there's that, because that will generate other kind of chemicals, like cortisol. So these chemicals, they will go to your weak spot. And your weakness is this area. So they will go worse. So when the person is stressed, that cortisol that's flushed down through the body, they will attack the weak part of the body. Some people may be joints. Some people maybe it's like some other stuff. They always go there. Right? So the right attitude you have to cultivate during this meantime, in the meantime, is nonchalant, at peace, always relaxed. Maintaining the body relaxed will short circuit the stress mechanism. Right? When we're stressed, our body is tense. So make sure it's always relaxed, always check the body is relaxed, and the feeling tone is that of contentment. It's okay. It's all right. You know? And you just observe what's happening. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Our body is made up of non-body. That's the Buddha's teaching. Table is made up of non-table. Floor is made up of non-floor. You are made up of non-you. We tend to take it as me, I, mine. But the body is made up of four elements. Solidity, fluidity, heat, and wind, air, oxygen. And even beyond that, all the billions of bacteria that's throughout the body, they have a particular job. They're not parasitic. It's part of the design. They actually do a particular job in the body. You know? They take care of producing different chemicals in the body. They signal different messages to the brain, part of the vagus nerve. So they have a job to do. So it's like a company with a bunch of workers, you know. If you deprive them of something, they go on strike. Or they cause havoc, you know. So everybody have their own part of the makeup, you know. So it's not completely what you eat. It's not completely what you eat. 20 people eating the same apple will have 20 different responses. So part of it is your microbiome, makeup, and part of it, of course, is the food. That actually relates to what you ask about that. You know, what's good for one person in a particular season, during a particular time, is different. And where you're born, you know, that particular region, bacteria are connected to that particular region. They're regionally located. So a human being that's produced in a particular region with that particular culture, particular food, particular set of bacteria, it's always better to eat that region's food. But that's not always necessarily true too, because if you don't live in that region, you live in a completely different climate and you try to go always eat that region. Meanwhile, you already have bacteria from this region, so you're changed, you know? So it's a matter of finding, identifying, balancing. So I know a very good acupuncturist who can help you. Yeah. She is, she's also an MD. So she has Western medicine training plus decades of like half a century of Chinese herbology, pharmacopic training in acupuncture. So I trust her. I don't go to her, but I've seen her work and how she treats patients. I've accompanied patients that go to her just to check her out, because so many of my students go to her, so I need to check out what she's doing. So I asked a question. I go in disguise, of course. So I check out what she's doing, so I trust her work. She will be able to identify. Like looking at you, because meditators also, just by decades of practicing, also have some experience with this without medical training. We're not trained like that. But we're certainly familiar with qi, energy. So, and the qi manifests in complexions, you know, and different stuff. So, it's part of kind of reading the student, too. You know? So, if you have questions, we can talk afterwards, too. Yeah. What is your name?
Marco.
Marco. Yeah. Okay. This morning is being about food and diet and livelihood and stuff. It's good. Anyone have questions related to that? Let's keep it in the same theme. Like maybe even sharing what you have observed within yourself, your diet and stuff. How many of you drink coffee? Coffee. Yes. Well, you have a question?
It kind of goes into the livelihood aspect, I think.
Okay.
I have a job that is very overstimulating, and I already find myself to be someone who is quickly overstimulated. And it kind of goes back to his point where this is like the longest time that I've sat to meditate. Typically, it's about 10 minutes, so this is the longest time I've ever meditated.
Is it your first time here?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, you came on a wrong date. Sunday, we sit for 40 minutes.
Yeah, so this was the longest time I've ever meditated, and automatically I was feeling pain in my back.
Yeah.
And just trying to figure out what was a good position for me to sit and sustain that time. And so I think what my question is as someone who is easily overstimulated, is there ever a, I feel like there's a possibility, but it just seems so distant to like where I won't be overstimulated. And trying to figure out where that really stems from, because I don't know if it's necessarily associated with diet or if it's like more of a mental thing, So, yeah.
So what are the symptoms of overstimulation? Mental activity, is that what you're referring to? Or
yeah, physical, I feel like my thoughts are, I can never quiet my thoughts. I even tried to try to do the counting method, and then I start thinking about other things, and then I'm like, oh wait, you were at 8, let's go back to 8, and then it just feels like a constant wheel. Mm-hmm.
So you wanted to know if it's ever possible to not be overstimulated?
Yes, and how can I take steps to get there, especially with the job that I have? Mm.
You have to have a method. That's your first defense. Mm-hmm. A method that works for you. Not too simple of a method. Are you very physical?
Like working out?
Working out, walking, you like walking, you like running, you like doing stuff.
Yeah, I do CrossFit. I also just like to, very active.
Okay, so a method that's like that. A method that's like that, or transforming what you already do, CrossFit, this and that, into meditative practice. That's where you start. So the principle of that method would be relaxing to it, be in the body, like somatically in the body, being aware of movements and sensations. Any tension spot that builds up while you're doing it, you learn to relax into it, still engage in the task. Right? If the task involves tension in certain area, like your legs when you're running, right? Of course, that's natural. But the other areas, you're very somatically, acutely aware of what's happening. The other areas are kind of relaxed into that. So what you want to do is to get to practice so that your heart, your mind, and your body are unified, are together. So when you're jogging, is jogging part of your thing?
Yeah. Okay.
When you're jogging, besides just visually aware of your surroundings so you don't trip, besides that, there are no wandering thoughts. Your method is embodiment. Movements and sensations. So you always have an anchor. Your body and mind are always together, unified. Start there. That's something that you excel at, something that you're good at. Now, you just tweak it to become a method. So something simple as counting or following the breath, not that effective. You have to prime yourself to start where you are. So whenever you exercise, body and mind are always together. So you discipline your mind not to be scattered, to be with the somatic experience, and there's a lot of experience. There's all kinds of things happening. So there's a lot of things to busy your mind. So the anchor is very concrete. This really physicality of being present. Right? So it's very easy to bring the mind back. Right? Once you, if you can do like 30-minute practice, exercise, and for that 30 minutes, like 20 minutes, you're super unified and learn to adapt and relax into the groove of the actions. So your mind and body are in the flow of that. You start there. And then for sitting meditation, traditionally, practitioners do prostrations. You may have seen people do that when you first came in. They do like the full body bows, they do prostrations. So what they're doing is not really, I mean, it's a gesture of reverence, you know. But the statue is just a tool to remind us to practice. And what most people are doing, at least in the Chan Zen tradition, is movements and sensations, just like your exercises. So they're doing, they start a little faster and then they go down very, very slow. So they pick up all the different movements and sensations and the body relaxes. And they build that as a transition segue into sitting. You can't just jump to sitting. So they prime their body and mind and heart. The concentration develops. And then when they go down to sitting, and when they come out of sitting, they do self-massage to come out. So you need a transition, you see. But, so that's what we do. Like when we were first practicing, we always do like 500 or more a day. Prostrations. This is when people are younger, like you. You know, like when I was in my early 20s, it's 500,000 a day. So the body is very limber. You know, I'm not really thinking about the Buddha or this and that. Just prostrating. You know. So when we set our intention, when we do prostration, we set our intention, repentance prostration. Shouldering the responsibility of mistakes that I've made, body, speech, and mind, and I repent. But during the prostration, we don't think about that. We set the intention, we just do the prostration. During the prostration, we're body and mind together. You see? And then we come out and we do the sitting. Okay, so when you exercise, set the intention. Set the intention, this is my meditation hall. This is my meditation hall. Time to meditate. And you just, one. You know, get that done. So you get into a habit. So your neural pathways are used to forming particular pattern. Now it's time to practice. You know what I'm saying? Your neural pathways are not used to that. Your neural pathway is used to letting things run wild. Just whatever you think, just like rain free, right? So that's the habit pattern. So you set the intention. When I work out, practice. So you don't do something extra. You do something that you already do. You introduce practice to something that you already do in daily life. So body and mind, one. Relax into it. Relax. Get into the groove. Focus. Relax. And the good chemicals, the dopamine, will start to come out. Right? And then when you sit, do you do yoga too or no?
Not really.
Okay. And then when you sit, you can do some stretchings. So when you stretch, so you're used to, body and mind one. Your movement and sensation when you stretch, you know. And then segue into the sitting. So when you, you have to get used to being in your body. In your skin, sensitized to tension spots and release. You do that, right? So when you're sitting in your body, embodied experiencing. Feel the sense of weight of your body. Like sit. The posturing, you realize where the muscle groups are. Any tension in the back, relax it. Posture, the sense of weight, like you're holding a sense of weight at the buttocks. When you're used to doing this, it's just the body is moving. Now the body is not moving, but you're used to embodied experiencing. That's it. And if you can't stay with it too long, don't get frustrated. You do this. Movements and sensation, just like when you work out. And you feel the cool air in the palm. That's different from the back of the hand. That's how sensitized you are. All the different sensations. Continuous movement. No stop. But very slow. And all the muscle groups that's involved in doing that. All the movements, repetitive, same, very relaxed, slow, ending with the thumbs touching. And how does that feel? And then continue again. Like that. So the method is the task at hand. Yeah, most people are hijacked by their thinking mind, right? So the other sense organs are not functioning properly. They're not in tune with what's happening. So I want you to bring a balance, introduce a balance in which you're very somatically aware. So eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind. The mind hijacks the previous five. So I want you to cultivate embodiment, the body faculty. Right? So when you're walking, getting a glass of tea, drinking coffee, cooking, walking the same flight of stairs, first bite of lunch, exercise, you're just completely embodied. If you practice that, in no time, your concentration level will shoot up. And you won't be hijacked, overstimulated. Right? So if you just cultivate a sensitivity to embodiment. Right? So any subtle shift, right? Stimulation, any subtle shift that in response to the stimulation, you'll be able to notice. Because you're more and more, you're cultivating an awareness of baseline, relaxed, grounded embodiment, baseline. Even when you're exercising, right? So when things go out of baseline, like stimulations, strong, you're aware and then whoo, relax, ground. So start where you are. Start with things you already do. Anything can be turned to a method. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Have a good rest of the day. Take care.